given the numbers that we're seeing over the past several days or even weeks, what do you think would be the more prudent track for the government in December? Is it to actually maintain the general community quarantine, for instance, in Metro Manila?
Yes, we see from the 8 months experience that it's physical and social distancing that really works. So if we are to maintain or stop the spread of the virus, then we have to maintain that particular intervention.
So there's something that you would also recommend to maintain GCQ, at least in Metro Manila and other high-risk areas?
Yes, I think that's the more prudent way to go, especially if the, as mentioned, the number of cases are not really that low. There's still a possibility of spiking because of the current high number of cases.
Mm-hmm. Now, based on your work on the ground with other doctors, are you actually seeing that somehow most of us who are actually enduring this this pandemic for the last 8 months, that somehow we have imbibed the protocol measures, the protocols, the health protocols in place as part of our regular life, so to speak? Or somehow do you see some relaxation on the part of many Filipinos already?
Yes, for healthcare professionals, I think it's built into their system already because they're really following rules and protocols. But I think for many of our lay people, the man on the street, it's very difficult to actually take on these protocols because you can see that they don't really feel that there are people getting sick, there are people dying, because what they see are more people going out. So I think there's a factor of complacency and denial that there's really a pandemic. They feel that the pandemic has is over.
Now, where do you attribute that? Is it because a lot of us have been fatigued already, having spent so much, so many months under this pandemic and under the community quarantine? That's why we're becoming even more complacent now?
That's part of it. But I think talking to people on the ground, it's more of a feeling of like everything is going back to normal. People are already out on the streets and they feel that less people are getting sick. They hear less people are dying. So they feel that it's over. That's why they have a feeling of confidence to go out and they have a feeling pandemic.
But it's not yet over, definitely.
Definitely. We believe that like the 1918-1917 pandemic, this could last for 2 years or more.
2 years?
Now, yes.
How do you think certain optics that we're seeing from certain government officials are affecting efforts by the government, including those who are not in government, health professionals, in terms of convincing people not to be complacent? For instance, recently, we saw pictures or videos of Secretary Harry Roque speaking before a crowd, standing close to each other, even if they're wearing face masks. And of course, also saw images of even Vice President Lenny Robredo shaking hands with typhoon victims, and even Senator Manny Pacquiao. How do you think this optics would affect the right message that the government or even health professionals are trying to send to the people?
I think that's part of this feeling of denial among our people that the pandemic is over because they see a lot of people already out on the streets. They see a lot of people congregating together and they're not sick and they don't get sick. So that's something that they interpret as the pandemic is over. But I hope our government officials will actually be the role model of really practicing the protocols, the minimum health protocols, wearing masks, wearing face shields, and physical distancing of 1 meter or more.
Okay. Now, let's talk about the science of this, because Secretary Roque was quoted as saying that basically you can forego with social distancing as long as you're wearing face masks.
No.
Is that true?
I don't think so. No. You know, what will happen if you get close together, face masks actually are not wearing their face masks properly, is that you'll still spread the virus because they'll cough, they'll sneeze wearing the face mask, but it's just covering their mouth and their nose is open. So the virus is still in the air. And there's also indirect contact, like spreading the virus through physical contact, your hands, your clothing, and even parts of your body, your hair can have the virus, and it can spread to other people. And when they rub their eyes, they rub their nose and mouth, the virus can get into their body.
Okay, let me complete that that quote attributed to him. Basically, social distancing, I'm paraphrasing, of course, need not be observed if people are wearing masks in an open air. Is that advisable?
Well, there's still no evidence to back that up. Still, the science says 1 meter apart. Because even if you're wearing masks, you, yourself, are wearing masks properly, but other persons are not, then you can spread the virus. In open air, yes, the chances of viral survival when it's open air is lowered, but it doesn't mean it doesn't happen.
So we still have to observe the minimum health protocols, whether it's open air or not.
Yes, because the science actually supports that. Excuse me. Yes, the science supports that. There's transmission of the virus if you are less than 1 meter apart.
Now, do these optics coming from our top government officials, again, it's not just Harry Roque, there are also reports of Senator Pacquiao doing the same, and even Vice President Lenny Robredo, how do these optics affect your efforts to convince people 8 months into the pandemic to actually still observe the minimum health standards, or are they actually making your life difficult, or your messaging more, even more difficult?
Yes, I think government and especially the Department of Health has to remind our top officials about maintaining the health protocols and making sure that they show this as an example to the public. They are the role models that the public will follow. So if they break the protocol, then it's a signal to the public to also break the protocols.
Okay. Now, of course, a lot of us are waiting for the vaccine to be rolled out, but it's not that easy because we're still waiting for the final approval of a vaccine that can be made commercially available. So there are certain companies already claim that their vaccine has this certain level of efficacy. But in this case, what do you think would be the right strategy in terms of rolling out the vaccines here in the Philippines once they become commercially available?
In any immunization program, I think basic to that is the, shall we say, social mobilization or the preparation of the community before you roll out a new vaccine. So even before the vaccines arrive, I think government has to prepare the community in terms of communicating to them what is the best strategy, what are the acceptable vaccines, and the reason or benefit, cost benefit, and advantages, disadvantages that come with the introduction of the new vaccine. People have to know that.
Are you seeing that so far? Or are you seeing that already? I mean, the messaging strategy that would actually educate the people, inform them about the benefits of getting vaccinated for COVID-19.
So far, I think that this is not yet happening, aside from the president talking about vaccinations. There are very few infomercials or messaging about the vaccine. And I've heard some of the, well, middle class saying that, well, there's a negative view of products coming from China. So they're saying that if government is going to give the China vaccine, they won't have the immunization. But if it's the US or the UK vaccine, then they'll get immunized. So it really has to start with preparing the community, informing them and being transparent about the advantages and disadvantages of certain vaccines.
By the way, there might be this tendency for a good number of Filipinos to think that rolling out the COVID-19 vaccine is also similar to the way the immunization program, let's say for measles, was done before. What is the basic difference? And which one is much more difficult?
Well, we've been immunizing measles for the past 30 years, and we still have measles disease, you know? It's a matter of really communicating to the public that the vaccination will not remove the COVID-19. It will slow its transmission, but it will not remove it altogether. There's only one disease that has been eradicated on the face of the earth, and that's smallpox. And it's possible, really, to eradicate a virus from the face of the earth, like we tried with polio. But 25 years after we introduced the polio eradication campaign, we're still battling polio. So don't give people false hope that if you start vaccinating with COVID-19 vaccine, that COVID-19 will disappear. So it's still important to have the minimum health protocols like wearing masks, wearing face shields, and social distancing, even if we start immunization.
How about the level of immunization that the government is targeting? Do you think that would actually lead to the so-called herd immunity?
Well, it actually depends on where you focus your vaccine on. Like right now, it cannot be like the entire country, you spread the vaccination evenly to all the municipalities and provinces. That will not work because we know there are high prevalence areas, high transmission areas, and therefore to have an effect, you have to concentrate your vaccination in these areas and not spread it evenly throughout the population. And it's very, very important to really map out your surveillance because at this point, I believe that we don't have a real picture of the entire country because of the low testing in many parts of the country. So actually, Metro Manila is highlighted because this is where about 50 to 60% of all the testing is being done. So we know many people are getting the virus here, but in other parts of the country, it might also show that the virus is there, but because of the low testing, we don't actually see the real picture.
Now, why is that, Secretary Obial? When we have been dealing with this for the past 8 months, and ordinarily you would think they would have already mapped out the scale of the virus after 8 months. Of course, we're focused on Metro Manila and other high-risk areas, but that's quite alarming what you said, that we might not have a good idea yet of how much infection is already happening or is also happening in other parts of the country because of low testing?
Yes. Like I mentioned the first COVID case in the country, which is a Chinese national, went to Dumaguete City. And what's the testing in Dumaguete? I think it's still very, very low. We also have reports of Surigao and Butuan having spike of cases, but I think they're only testing 30 to about 50 cases a day. How can you get the true picture in those areas?
Mm. And so far, do you think that there's still this big problem or serious problem of people not convinced, or a good number of Filipinos somehow shying away from vaccination because of the Dengvaxia controversy before? And what do you think would be the best strategy to actually convince them that vaccines work?
I think it's not just Dengvaxia. There's really a segment of the population where overall there is vaccine hesitancy because of the concept of many people that natural infection is better than artificial, which is through vaccination. And that's been a global movement towards that. A lot of people, especially in the developed countries, are not getting vaccinated or immunized. And with the thing that happened with Dengvaxia, I think that concept and that vaccine hesitancy was further fueled in this country. So I think that's also one of the things that the Department of Health has to deal with, the social preparation, so that people will actually have a buy-in to this concept of getting vaccinated. Because let's say, for example, our concentration is, let's say, in Metro Manila, we really have a high number of cases. But it's not evenly spread in Metro Manila. Let's say Quezon City, Manila City are high prevalence areas. That's why you need a concentration. And then you find out it's in the low income sectors that you need to prioritize and vaccinate. And I think that's also what the government and the president has been saying. But what if these low income people, because of previous experience, vaccine hesitancy, they're the ones who doesn't want to have the vaccination? What will you now do with all the millions of vaccines that you bought?
Precisely.
And your strategy is not working. It's not stopping the viral spread.
But do you still see that hesitancy? Given the things that have been happening over the past 8 months, one would think that even those who were adamantly against vaccination would have been convinced somehow that at this time, because of the pandemic, we need vaccines.
Well, most of those talks that you say we need vaccines come from the middle and upper class. Why don't they do a survey of the lower socioeconomic class, which is what is being targeted now, the low income, the indigent members of the population, if they are really convinced that they need this vaccination?
Okay, so it's important to get a picture of their sentiment regarding vaccination.
Yes, because we rolled out the measles campaign right now. I think it was October 26 to November 25. And still that's measles and polio. And still the coverage is still very low. I think it's about 70%. And we wanted to get a 90% coverage in the areas which were targeted.
So this is one of the nitty-gritty issues that the government needs to address. Vaccine hesitancy or acceptance on the part of those composing the majority of the population that need to be that needs to be vaccinated.
Yes, that's why I'm telling you and government probably that social mobilization is very important. People have to understand what are the advantages and disadvantages of having this COVID vaccine rolled out, especially in the most vulnerable and the most high prevalence areas for transmission.
Now, in terms of the actual rollout, how should it be done? Can you use the model that we have been using in other diseases before? For instance, do you need to go house to house, or do you need to gather people in a certain area? What would be the concrete strategy in terms of actually rolling out the vaccines once they become commercially available?
Actually, if you did your social preparation diligently and accurately, I think you will determine which a strategy is best for an area, because you know the pulse of the people on the ground. You know how they accept or don't accept this particular intervention. So you can strategize based on that. And as a former health leader, I think one size doesn't fit all. You have to have a strategy that is tailored fit for a particular area.
Okay, former Health Secretary Pauline Obiang, thank you for joining us this morning, ma'am.
Thank you.